Previously on TB, I was able to discuss on the different modes of TB transmission, especially touching on possible ways that extrapulmonary tuberculosis can develop. You can watch that video by clicking on the annotations below or by going to my YouTube watch page and searching through the videos tab. Hello, my name is Dr. Zero Miller and welcome to TB, the show that discusses things about tuberculosis and its management. Today we're going to talk about how tuberculosis kills a patient. Now before we start, we need to understand certain things. TB is a bacilli. It is a bacteria. It is not a poison. It does not release spores just like anthrax that can kill a person. It does not contain an endotoxin like cholera that can affect how the normal physiology of the human body, and it does not have a coat that acts like a poison just like other viruses or bacteria that can kill instantly. TB grows like a mold, a persistent mold that keeps growing and growing and then spreads eventually throughout the entire body. Even though our immune system tries to kill it, and eventually it doesn't. When you get infected with a tuberculosis bacteria, three things can happen. The very first thing that can happen, and is the most common, is nothing. You can get infected, but you won't get the disease, tuberculosis. The bacilli is either destroyed by the immune system because it gets seeded in a place or in a part of your body that cannot support the bacteria, or it can stay inside your human body for a very long time in a place where it becomes dormant and eventually becomes activated. This is what pulmonologists and infectious disease experts call latent tuberculosis. The other two things that can happen depend on whether the patient is immunocompromised or immunocompetent. Immunocompromised means that there are certain factors that can affect the normal functioning of the immune system, hence making the TB spread far faster than it usually should. An infection starts when one bacteria or mycobacteria tuberculosis, bacilli, starts to seed in one organ of the human body. It usually takes 10 bacilli to infect a human being, but for the purposes of illustration, I will be using this small brown box as a representative of the TB bacilli. The first cells that detect a TB infection are usually the local macrophages of the invaded organ, usually the alveolar macrophages or the macrophages in the brain or in the skin macrophages, for example. They are usually unable to kill the bacteria. However, but they ingest the bacteria anyway and is able to contain the infection inside them for a small time being. The patient usually does not feel any symptoms at this point. However, when the bacteria starts to divide, which is, as explained in earlier episode, a slow division, the macrophages are strained or will require additional help So they send out signals for other immune cells to help them. The bacteria will continue to divide and divide inside the primary macrophages, and this is when the initial symptoms of tuberculosis starts in the patient. You see, the immune cells tries to contain the infection inside the macrophages, so it uses up the patient's nutrients just so that the immune cells continue to function containing the infection. Usually within weeks, the patient starts to lose weight and also begins to have a loss of appetite. These symptoms are not specific to tuberculosis, but it is almost universally found in among tuberculosis patients. The loss of appetite and the weight loss begins to increase in severity as the complexity of containing the infection or the tuberculosis starts to develop into a more severe form. Through the cytokine signaling system, the primary macrophage then recruits other macrophages to help contain the growing bacteria. Macrophages then combine to create one giant multinuclear cell. This cell, or multinuclear cell, is also known by another name called a Langhans cell, wherein the bacteria is being contained not only by alveolar macrophages but also other cells of the immune system surrounding this multinuclear cell. TB still continues to divide inside this multinucleated cell and continues to derive nutrients from the patient, thus creating symptoms still of anorexia and weight loss. As the numbers of the TB bacilli grow, the complexity of the multinucleated cell also grows and then creates a mass, a visible mass, which is called a granuloma or a TB granuloma, also called as a tuberculoma. As TB divides and replicates inside the tuberculoma, the mass enlarges, and if the mass is located outside of the pulmonary system, it exerts a mass effect. It pushes the normal physiological structures aside and may disrupt function, especially if it is located in the brain or a meningeal tuberculoma. The patient starts to have symptoms that are compatible with stroke. There will come a time when the human body will not be able to tolerate the growing needs of the immune system to contain this TB bacilli, and eventually it will bog down and TB will break out of this granuloma. This is now the time when tuberculosis will become manifest, especially in the pulmonary system or in the lung, where the cough will then start, and then there, as the parenchyma is eaten by the invading tuberculosis bacteria, the patient will then start to have hemoptysis, and then the bacteria will then start to spread to other organs. Tuberculosis in the gastrointestinal tract starts to manifest as chronic diarrhea that is not relieved by usual antibiotics given to diarrheal patients. In the brain, tuberculosis manifests as a meningeal irritation or meningitis, wherein the patient starts to have seizures or loss of consciousness. if the organs involved are essential, like the brain, the heart, the kidneys, the patient usually dies because of the mass effect created by the tuberculoma. When it comes to the lungs or the other organs of the human body, the tubercle bacilli just creates the cycle of seeding to other organs and then creation of tuberculoma and then the rupture of tuberculoma, and then the ensuing process just goes on and on until the patient usually dies because of malnutrition and or sepsis. Now, the pathogenesis that I've just described pertains to how TB kills a patient who has a competent or a normally functioning immune system. Now, there are patients that get tuberculosis because they are immunocompromised, or they have an immature immune system, just like in kids, or they have a dysfunctional immune system, just like in the elderly, and or they acquired an immunodeficiency disease, just like in HIV/AIDS, or they are taking medications, just like those patients who are, you know, on cancer chemotherapy, especially those that have leukemia. The World Health Organization classifies this subset of patients as a high-risk group of patients that can have tuberculosis. Among this high-risk group of patients that can have immunocompromise and subsequent tuberculosis infection also include those patients that have diabetes and also those with a lower socioeconomic background, like those living in city slums or those who have poor access to healthcare. Tuberculosis in the immunocompromised is far different from tuberculosis in immunocompetent patients. In immunocompetent patients, there is the development of tuberculoma and eventual development of casus necrosis because of a normally functioning immune system. In the immunocompromised, the TB spreads rather easily, which is why it becomes disseminated early in the course of the disease. This is why most physicians think of immunocompromise when they encounter tuberculosis that is disseminated or in a very sick patient. Death also follows very easily in an immunocompromised patient, which may occur within weeks of infection because of this lack of containment procedures that is found in immunocompetent patients. Immunocompromised patients usually die of organ failure. For example, in AIDS patients who have pulmonary tuberculosis, they don't develop the same pathogenesis as in immunocompromised patients where there is development of tuberculoma. Instead, they have abscess formation, effusion, secondary to a TB pneumonia, wherein the whole of the lung parenchyma involved with TB infection is inflamed because of the widespread or disseminated TB infection. The final picture of a patient with TB infection that is not treated is usually skin and bones. This is why tuberculosis is considered in the Bible, or is called by its older name as consumption. Whenever you hear consumption in the Bible, or consumed by disease, it means he was afflicted with this tuberculosis, wherein the disease actually eats away the nutrients in the body. And that's all the time we have for today. Thank you very much for watching on TV, and make sure to subscribe to my channel.
so that you can get more on TV every Tuesdays at 9:00 p.m. And also you can browse through my YouTube watch page. Also get updated with me by following me on Twitter at twitter.com/0MD and on Facebook at facebook.com/0Melia. Again, thank you very much for watching and mabuhay.